test of time. They're in the books. If you need a sheet, we got a few extra sheets. Number 527, first, second, and last, glory to his name as the choir comes down on the stage.
Glory to Let's shake hands, okay? Let's welcome our visitors tonight. Everybody, welcome our visitors tonight. Delighted to be back in the house of the Lord, and we welcome each and every one of you. We're glad that you're here today on Sunday night as well. We had a great service this morning, good liberty to preach, good liberty to worship, and feel like it should be no different tonight. So while they're getting ready, I want to welcome a couple couples. I want to welcome Kristen and Cody. Stand up, Kristen, with the baby, all right? God bless you. That little baby was born very premature, stayed in the NICU, and already out of the NICU, which is great. Baby's doing good. Let's give her a round of applause. God bless you. Glad y'all are better. And Mr. Howard, we're glad you're here. Just keep coming. Bring her back. That's the thing to do. And then I want to welcome Kaylee and Wayne. I think Kaylee's back here. Thank you. That's great. So it's like at his place Sunday morning, our place Sunday night. We'll take the compromise for right now, all right? But we welcome y'all. Glad you're back from wherever you went. And happy marriage, and God bless you, all right? Worship the Lord with the youth choir, okay? Come on, young people.
Struggling through my life and the choices I have made, looking to the right and left, trying to find my way. Coming to a crossroad where I caught a glimpse of Him, the Savior reaching out to me with hands that bore my sin. For no greater love was shown than on the cross at Calvary. I decided then and there the choice was real to me. I'll take Jesus. If opportunity should arise up like the sun, shine so bright on all the promises, what I could become. No ring hands of compromise could offer wealth and fame, tempting me to turn around, denying Jesus' name. Well, I'd rather be a poor man and have riches in the truth. So without a second thought, let me tell you what I'd do. Well, I'd take Jesus. I'll take Jesus. I'll take Jesus. Jesus. I'll take Jesus.
I'll take Jesus anytime.
He means more to me than the world you see.
There's no question in my mind. I'll take Jesus anytime.
Well, he
heavens. If y'all feel like singing one, you're more than welcome to. Tell you, the difference between us and those that are unsaved is that very song that they just sung. And that, Brother Randy, that Jesus passed by. Had he not passed by, we'd still be in our sin, still be kicking up our heels, still be just as lost as anybody else. So we ought to thank God that he passed by our way. We really should. We appreciate it. And Kaylee, I want to thank you again. I don't think I can recall a young lady getting married and coming back in the next service and help us in the youth choir. Thank you. And we may have had some, but I think that's great. I appreciate it so much. And keep doing it. Keep doing it if you want to, all right? Let's have the ushers come on down. We'll get the regular tithe and the regular offering. Want you to give us unto the Lord tonight. Appreciate a giving church, a tithing church. Appreciate people that support the work of God here at Mountain View, all right? God bless you. The ushers are coming to serve you. And we've got Brother Nathan Griffith lined up to preach tonight. You can tell my voice is just really, really weak anyway. It would have been weak if I tried, and I knew it would have been. So we've already got Brother Nathan ready to go. So pray for him while you're sitting here. Right now you give tonight, and we'll get our singers ready. All right, go ahead. Brother Landon's coming around and pray for us and dedicate the offering.
Lord, we thank you one more time for the opportunity to come into your house tonight, Lord. Thank you for the service you gave us this morning. Thank you for the way you helped our preacher this morning, the message you brought to us, Lord. Help us to take it to heart, Lord, as we go home this week, Lord. God, I thank you for the opportunity to give tonight, Lord. Thank you for your blessings on us, Lord, the jobs you give us, Lord, and let us work. And, Lord, the money you let us keep, Lord, and bless us with over and over again with, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to give a little bit back to you, Lord, to fund your church and your work, God. And we pray tonight, Lord, for Brother Nathan, God. Bless him, give him liberty and unction as he preaches, Lord. Help him to preach with us, saith the Lord. Lord, touch these singers that are coming, Lord, and bless them, Lord, and anoint them. God, I pray for the one that's lost in here tonight, God. Would you save him for us everlasting too late and give us a good week. And we thank you for all your many blessings. Thank you for all you do. Thank you most of all for saving us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. All right, Brother Jimmy and Jake's going to get ready. I asked where Jesse was. He's down at Wahoo Baptist Church. And he's dating courting a girl at Brother Mark Stroud's church, I believe. So that's where it's going on there. But this week, there's not supposed to be any rain. It could change. I don't know. I'm not a weatherman. But if some of you men could get our heads together, it looks like when I glanced out there, I think they've either sprayed the grass or I couldn't tell. It looks like something's already started to be done. But We're going to have to use a Harley rake, a four-wheeler, or a tractor. We're going to get that baseline. I think they're going to do the baseline. So some of you men talk about it, and we'll get a plan together, all right? Because baseball season is just around the corner for the Mountain View Christian Academy, all right? God bless you while these folks sing.
I have been through many heartaches on this road, but my Lord has always helped me carry my load. When I look at all I've had to face, and I know I've made it by His grace. It's not what I have done or how good I have been, but through His blood I know I'll make it in. It's not by my strength, for on the cross He took my place. He did it all by His grace. It's not by works that anyone should boast, but through His blood we are in God's fold. The plan of salvation that my Lord has made came to existence through and by His grace. It's not what I have done or how good I have been, but through His blood I know I'll make it in. It's not by my strength, for on the cross He took my place. He did it all by His grace. He did it all by His grace.
Thank you. Thank you. You say amen to that? Great, great. I appreciate it. Appreciate it very, very much. Jake, would you sing in tenor? Great. Singing tenor. How old are you, Jake? About 19 or 20? Jake, how old are you? 20 years old, singing tenor for the Lord. Isn't that good? Appreciate it so much. Now, this Wednesday night, we'll be right back here at 7 p.m. in the regular Wednesday night service. We've had the last two Wednesday nights for choir practice, and we might do some more of that in the future. But this Wednesday night, we'll convene, come together during the middle of the week, and have regular prayer meeting, church service, singing and preaching, and all those good things. All right, y'all ready? Brother Cam Smith and them, and then we'll preach. I mean, we'll have a right.
You say today than ever, and I just wanted you to know.
Amen. Thank God.
Where there is fear, Lord, you will hide me when winds of danger.
To see these young adults serving the Lord. That's what we're after here. That's what we want. That's our goal, our aspiration, our prayer, our desire is that young people would reach the age of 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 and still want to stay in church and sing and serve God and be involved. Amen. I mean, be involved. And we appreciate several here in the church that are that way. God bless you. All right, let's get our Bibles in our hand. Brother Nathan, you come. Appreciate Brother Nathan. What happened to your wife? She go to the nursery. She got the little guy in the nursery. I talked to him yesterday before I ever got home from Nashville, Tennessee, and asked him to be ready for tonight. And so he said he'd be honored to. And so he's going to preach for us. And let's give him our undivided attention. Brother Nathan Griffith. All right, God bless you. Turn your mic on.
Had it. All right, thank you, Pastor. I am very nervous tonight. I'm always nervous. Y'all scare me. I don't know why it is, but every time I get to preach at home, I'm scared out of my mind. But thank you, Pastor, for the opportunity. As he said, I am honored. It's always a blessing to preach at home, and I'm just thankful for the Lord and how good he's been in my life. And I appreciate all the singing tonight, Brother Cam and Miss Lisa and Emily. I love that song. I talked about some of that this morning in Sunday school, and just amazes me sometimes just how good the Lord is, and letting him know it'd be a good thing for all of us. But go with me tonight in the book of Genesis, chapter number 45. Probably going to be talking tonight, preaching about, if the Lord will help us, probably, arguably, one of my favorite characters of all the Bible. We'll be discussing a man named Joseph in Genesis 45, and honestly, even as far back as Genesis 37, after we read our text, we'll probably go back to Genesis 37, and if the Lord will help us, we'll preach all the way back through to Genesis 45, and I hope we can get all that done in a reasonable amount of time without boring anybody. But I also want to just say this before I get started on my message this evening, that Joseph is often overlooked in the Bible. You rarely hear men or preachers or say things about Joseph saying that he's a type of Christ or anything like that. But if you look at Joseph's life and the way he lived it and the way he handled himself in some pretty cruddy situations, you could absolutely say that Joseph absolutely was a type of Christ in the Bible. You could think of the time, and I won't preach this tonight, I'll just reference this before I get going, where he was tempted in his fleshly body with Potiphar's wife. She essentially threw herself at the man named Joseph. We know that Joseph was a servant in Potiphar's house, and Potiphar's wife had an eye for Joseph, and she threw herself at him on multiple occasions, and what you would always see is Joseph found a way out of that. And even one point in time, she got him backed up in a corner where really couldn't do no wrong. She got him in there by himself, where there's nobody else around. And what did Joseph do? He fled the scene. He said, "I'm getting out of town." And I just tell you like this, not many men have that wherewithal. Not many young men, not many older men have that wherewithal. And I see, I'm not saying that he was a sinless man, but I'm seeing a type of sinlessness in Joseph. He said, "I know I'm not going to get trapped here in this conundrum that this lady's got me in, who's got an eye for me. I'm getting out of here." And then you know about his brothers and how they treated him. Just so many crummy situations, this man named Joseph. And I'm just going to be honest with you, he's a biblical hero to me. I look at Joseph and I see a man that I want to be like. I see a Christian that I want to live like. And I'm challenged when I think of this man named Joseph. This is just big in my heart right now. And I'll tell you what I really want to do. With the Lord's help, I want to preach to you this evening just basically about the whole life of Joseph. If I can do it in just 7 or 8 chapters in 30, 35 minutes is what I like to do. Let's begin reading in Genesis chapter number 45. The Bible says this in verse number 1. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him, and he cried, "Cause every man to go out from me." And there stood no man with him, while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard. And Joseph said unto his brethren, "I am Joseph. Doth my father yet live?" And his brethren could not answer him. They were troubled at his presence. Verse number 4, and Joseph said unto his brethren, "Come near unto me, I pray thee." And they came near, and he said, "I am Joseph, your brother, whom ye sold into Egypt. Now therefore be ye not grieved, nor angry with yourselves that ye sold me hither, for God did send me before you to preserve lives. For these 2 years hath the famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there shall be neither earing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you a posterity in the earth, and to save your lives by great deliverance." Verse number 8, "So now it was not you that sent me hither." Well, there's a lot in that verse, and we're going to touch that here again in a little while. "But God, and he hath made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of his house, and a ruler over all the land of Egypt." Let's pray just for a moment. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you, Lord, so much for this opportunity, God, to stand behind this sacred desk just for a little while. Lord, I pray, Lord, if it be your will, God, please touch me. God, please touch my mouth. Please touch my mind. God, give my mouth the unction to speak, Lord, what you would have us to say. God, I pray you give my mind the clearness of thought to understand even my own thoughts and rightly depict them and give them to these dear people. God, and above all this, Lord, I pray your divine spirit would move in the hearts of your people. God, and you would do the preaching through me, God, and you'd walk between every pew, God, and you would identify the needs of our hearts and show us our errors and our faults. God, I pray you do all this for your sake and for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Go back with me now to the book of Genesis chapter number 37. What I just read to you is my text verses. That's where I'll take my text. But I'm not going to preach to you my text immediately. I want to go back to the beginning of Joseph's life and the beginning of Joseph's story and build the message and then bring you back to Genesis number 45. As we've talked about already, we know that Joseph is a familiar name in the Bible, and we know that he was a good man. But how did Joseph get his start? Look in Genesis 37, verse number 3. The Bible says this, "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that his father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him." I don't know if you noticed when we read our text verses in Genesis 45 and verse number 1 through 8, I believe we read, but it didn't make mention of the hate that Joseph's brothers had for him. But if we go to Genesis 37, we notice that they indeed did hate him. And the title of my message tonight, and we'll preach it to you, is this: Doing Right to Everyone Who's Done You Wrong. I told you that Joseph handled himself right in so many bad situations. He just did the right thing. Just time and time again, this man Joseph did the right thing. And I want to begin, in order for me to show you just how right Joseph was, I'm going to have to show you just how wrong some other people were. And I hate to be negative tonight, but in order for anyone to be right, there's always another side of the story, and somebody was wrong. And I want to show you, I want to paint the picture. I'm going to do like my pastor and take my coat off. Maybe it'll help me preach a little better. Seems to help him. I'm nervous. I'm hot, and I'm already sweating, and I know that that coat's got to come off. But in Genesis 37, verse number 4 and verse number 5, we know, or verse 3 and verse 4, we know first off that Joseph's brothers hated him. What you found in Genesis chapter 45 was Joseph, and we'll preach to it. We'll get to the point. What you find there is he was extending mercy. He was extending grace to his brothers in their time of need. But he had no reason to do that. The Bible tells us, it plainly teaches that his brothers hated him. And it says in verse number 3, now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age and made him a coat of many colors. I'm going to just say this. You know, Joseph didn't ask for that. He didn't ask for his father to love him more than his brothers. He didn't ask for the coat of many colors. He was just the son of his father's old age, and that's the treatment that his father gave him. Joseph did not really have a card in the fight. He didn't ask to be hated. He didn't want to be hated. He wanted his brothers to love him, but it was the action of someone else that caused his brothers to hate him. Verse number 4, the Bible says, and when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. So not only did I want you to notice this, women, not only did Joseph's brothers absolutely hate him, listen, the Bible says that they couldn't even do any good thing to him. What's it say at the end of verse number 4? And they could not speak peaceably unto him. It was one thing for them to hate him and keep it quiet. It's one thing for you and I to have somebody that we don't like and for us to disdain them and have a misfortune of mind and will towards them. But it says they couldn't. Hey, I'll be honest with you. There's some people throughout the course of my life that I've not really liked a whole lot. But I'd still walk by them. Hey, how you doing? Hey, did you have a good day? How's your favorite ball team doing? Did you kill any deer last week? Are the fish biting for you? I may not have necessarily liked them, but I still maintain the fellowship. What does Joseph's brothers say in the Bible? It says they couldn't even speak peaceably to him. They didn't even want to talk to him. They didn't want to say, Joseph, how was your day? Joseph, how you doing? How's your week been? How's dad been treating you? How's your coat of many colors fitting? No. They didn't even care. They hated the young man so much that they could not even speak to him in a peaceable manner. Hey, and can I just remind you that we're not talking about somebody that's not family. We're not talking about somebody that's never met him. We're not talking about people that literally did not know him from Adam. We're talking about his own blood, okay? I've got three brothers and a sister. The same would be said if they literally hated me, born in the same womb and the same father, raised in the same home, and they hated me. And they would not even speak peaceably. They wanted nothing to do with me. That's Joseph's brothers. I'd say that's about doing man as much wrong as any man can do. They absolutely hated him for something that he could not control, for something that he had no say-so in, so much so that they did not even want to speak to the man. What a way to be treated. I want you to notice first off how they hated him, how they wanted nothing to do with him. Let's keep reading. Verse number 5, and Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. It's like it grew day by day. The more Joseph grew and the more Joseph matured in being a young man, the more his brethren hated him. It's like he just couldn't do nothing right. They hated him, and they more and more they hated him. Verse number 6, and he said unto them, hear, I pray you this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheave arose and also stood upright. Behold, our sheaves stood round about and made obeisance to my sheath. Verse number 8, and his brethren said unto him, shalt thou indeed reign over us, or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more of his dreams and of his words. And now you find them, they already hated him because of his person. They already hated him because of what his father gifted him. But now they're hating him because of his spiritual gifts. He had an ability to dream. God had given him ability to see things and prophesy. And then now they're hating him the more. And it says they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. I won't read all these verses, but if you went from verse number 8 to verse number 19, you would find that Joseph's brothers were sent by Jacob, their father, into the field to do something. And Jacob come to Joseph. He said, hey, I want you to go check on your brethren. And long story short, as the text would transpire, he would do just that. He would do what his father said. And he would go check on his brothers. And they seen him coming from afar off. And guess what they said? They said, hey, there's that dreamer. He's coming our way. They hated him. They could not speak peaceably to him. They hated him because of his gifts. And then fourthly, they made fun of the young man. They seen him coming from a distance. Says, there's that dumb brother of ours that has all these goofy dreams that don't even make any sense. Just they hated him with such a hate that I don't even believe you and I could put in our minds a capacity and realize I've never been hated on that level. I've been lucky. I'll be honest with you. I'm sure somebody down, of course, around my life is from a distance kind of jested or made fun at me, but I never even had to know about it.
But Joseph knew about it, and they made fun of him. Verse number 18, the Bible says this, when they saw him afar off, even before they came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. Then you see in verse number 19, it says, and they said one to another, behold, this dreamer cometh. So they're making fun of him in verse number 19. They said, here comes the dreamer. And then verse 18, this is what we see, really, the sin of all sins in this story. The Bible says this, when they saw him afar off, even before they came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. They hated the young man. He'd never done anything to them. They made fun of him. They wouldn't speak peaceably to him. And now you find his 10 brothers. He has 11. He's the 12th. But one's too young to see all this. One's not in the picture yet. And now they're conspiring to kill him. Look with me now in verse number 20. The Bible says this, come now therefore and let us slay him and cast him into the pit, into some pit, and we will say, save evil beasts, that some evil beast devoured him, and we shall see what will come of his dreams. And Reuben heard it and delivered him out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. What you see there, and it's not ever really preached, and I don't know why I'm preaching it, because I feel almost unworthy to even bring this out. But what you see right there in verse number 21 is a little picture of grace in a bad situation. You got a young man named Reuben who's one of his brothers, and he's not, conscience is not clear. He's not right. He's not done right by Joseph. He's hated him, and he's made fun of him, and he's not spoken peaceably of him. But at least he said, let's not kill him. Let's not shed his blood. We don't have to hate him that much. Not preached often, but what you do see there is a picture of grace in Joseph's life in a crummy situation. Here his brothers are conspiring to kill him, and here comes grace all of a sudden, steps on the scene in the form of a rebellious brother, and he says, hello, boys, hey, I don't like him any more than y'all do, but I don't see no sense in we killing him. Let's do a little something different. Verse number 22, and Reuben said unto them, shed no blood, but cast him into the pit that is in the wilderness, that lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him of their hands, to deliver him unto his father again. And it came to pass when Joseph was come up to his brethren that they stripped Joseph of his coat of many colors that was on him, and they took him and cast him into a pit, and the pit was empty, and there was no water in it. And they sat down and eat bread, and they lifted up their eyes, and a company of Ishmaelites come from Gilead with their camels bearing spicery and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt. And Judah said unto his brethren, what profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come and let us sell him to these Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother in our flesh, and his brethren were content. I'll say this to you. Reuben was, he reasoned with them not to kill him. But then in verse number 22, it says that the biggest thing that he was reasoning, he was stalling on to kill him, is they didn't want his blood on their hands. So, yeah, there was a little bit of grace there, and they decided not to kill him. But it was ultimately so that they didn't have to look so bad. They were worried about what they were going to look like and what Dad was going to think. So they come up with this scheme to throw him in a pit. And then they saw these Ishmaelites coming, these traitors. And they said, I'll tell you what we'll do, boys. I'll tell you what we'll just do. If we kill him, the blood's going to be on our hands. But we can sell him and we can get monetary gain from him. How evil. I hate to be so negative, but Joseph's brothers are literally getting worse verse by verse by verse. They hate the man. They make fun of him. They won't even have anything to do with him. They want to kill him. Now they want to sell him so that they can gain from it. What a terrible situation. And I'll spare you the rest of the reading. You know the rest of the story. They did indeed sell Joseph into slavery. These people that bought Joseph took Joseph to a place called Egypt. And he was bought in Egypt at a slave trade market, or I guess however all that works. And you know the story, he went to become a slave of Potiphar's house. And throughout his life, the Lord used Joseph continually. I think the grace of God and the mercy of God, despite ill treatment by family, God was merciful and gracious to Joseph, and he blessed the young man. He said, won't nobody else love you, so I'll love you, Joseph. Won't nobody else speak peaceably to you, so I'll make a place for you. I'll make you a home in the wilderness. I'll give you something, and I'll bless your life, and I'll use your life. In spite of the way you were treated in your home country, I love you. What you see throughout the Bible in Genesis 38 and Genesis 39 and even into Genesis 40. You just see about how God used Joseph line upon line, verse upon verse, chapter upon chapter. You find over and over again, you'll see the Bible will say things like, and he used Joseph and he prospered Joseph and he growed Joseph. Just he used him and he blessed everything in the young man's life. God did that. But as the story would progress, we know that Joseph was gifted with this ability to dreams. And there was a man one day named Pharaoh that had a dream. And Pharaoh dreamed a dream that he could not interpret. And by way of life circumstances, Joseph had made it to a place where We talked about the sin with Potiphar's wife, that he escaped and evaded. Well, Potiphar's wife lied about Joseph and had Joseph thrown in jail. She made up a lie to get Joseph thrown in jail because she was mad that she couldn't have him. And he got him thrown in jail. And even he was innocent, he did no wrong, but he got him thrown in jail. When I was in the jailhouse, he interpreted a dream for some individuals that were also in jail. And then word got back to Pharaoh when he dreamed a dream that he couldn't interpret. Hey, there's a boy down there named Joseph in a prison. He's got this gift. He can interpret dreams. And Joseph sent for him and said, go get this young man. I've got something that's perplexing me. I don't understand. I've dreamed a dream, and I need someone to interpret it. And I won't preach all of it because I'm preaching basically tonight from Genesis 37 all the way to 45. And I can't read every verse. But ultimately what would happen was they would come to Joseph and he would interpret the dream and they would say, hey, get him out of jail. He's coming to my house and I'm going to make him the ruler of my house and I'm going to bless him for his dream. And then Pharaoh realized, and long story short, the dream that he dreamed was the dream of the coming 7 years of famine. Joseph told Pharaoh, what you dreamed is it's impending, it's coming, it's on the forecast. God is going to judge the land. There'll be no food, there'll be no supply. We're going to have to do something. In the years of plenty, we need to build up storehouse. We need to fill up the cupboards, and we need to get the corn, and we need to bring it in. We need to do something to sustain the living, sustain the nation, sustain the city. And Joseph presented that to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, well, we need a man that's got the Spirit of God on him. We need a man to do this thing that you tell us of. Long story short, Joseph was indeed picked by Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, you're the man. You're the man that I want to get the corn. You're the man that I want you to reap the harvest, and I want you to bring in the supply and put it in the storehouses so in the years of famine we can make it, we can survive. And Joseph did that. And what you find as you go in chapter number 41 of Genesis, chapter number 42, I believe it starts in verse number 42, we enter into a season of famine. But before we entered into a season of famine, remember I told you that Pharaoh had prospered. Joseph had got him out of jail. Look with me in Genesis. I hear the pages turning. It only makes sense for me to tell you where I'm going next. Go with me to Genesis. Let's see. Genesis 41, I believe. And we'll start reading in verse 45. Let me pause just for a second. In Genesis 41, verse number 45, the Bible says this. And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Ziphnath-Paniah, and he gave him a wife, Asenath, and the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On. And Joseph went out over all the land of Egypt. And this is what I'm getting ready to read to you, some of what I've already preached to you. And Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh and king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went throughout all the land of Egypt. And in the 7 years of plenteous, in the seven plenteous years, the earth brought forth handfuls. And he gathered up all the food of the 7 years which was in the land of Egypt and laid up the food in the cities. And the food of the fields, which was round about every city, and laid up in the same. And that's all that I've already brought to you tonight. And verse 49, the Bible says, and Joseph gathered corn as the sand of the sea, very much until he left numbering, for it was without number. And Joseph, and here's where I'm going to take my first 2 points tonight. Everything I've told you has been introduction, building the text, but I do want to take a couple points before I get back to Genesis 45. And here's where I'll give you my first point. It says this in Genesis 49, Joseph, or verse 50, and Joseph was born 2 sons before the years of famine came, which Asenath, the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On, bare unto him. That was his wife. And Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. Notice what your Bible says. For God said, he hath made me forget all my toil and all my father's house. I read that some weeks ago. I had actually been praying and asking the Lord to give me a new Sunday school lesson, really, or a new message. And the Lord laid this thought on my heart. He sent me to Genesis, and I read these things. And as I read these scriptures, I was literally amazed at the attitude of Joseph. Here's a young man treated worse than probably just nearly anybody in your Bible other than the Lord Jesus himself. Hated by his own blood family, left to die, sold into slavery, lied on by Potiphar's wife, put in bad situation after bad situation. And the Bible says this, after he's begun to prosper and Pharaoh's given him a place to serve and he's gathered all the fruits of the land preparing for the 7 years of famine, the Bible said in verse 49 and 50 that he had children. It says this, and when Joseph was born, 2 sons. And Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. I don't know if you have a Scofield Bible. It doesn't matter if you don't, but I do. It has a little word there beside the M on Manasseh. And if you reference it, it means, it says forgetting. And I can't help but look at that verse and think I can't run past that, because he's naming his first son Manasseh, which the Bible is implying, and Mr. Schofield thought that it means to forget. It says, "For God hath made me to forget all my toil and all my father's house." You know what I see in Joseph? You know what I see out of a man mistreated by his brethren, mistreated by his family? I saw a man that decided not to major on the treatment of others towards him. I see a young man that said, "Hey, though my brothers hate me, God loves me. Though I've been treated unfairly, and though the circumstances of my life have not always come out like a bed of roses, I'm not going to be bitter. I'm not going to dwell on what happened when I was 17 when my brothers hated me and they sold me into slavery." It says that he chose to forget. It says, "And Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh, for God said, he hath made me to forget all my toil at my and all my father's house." The Lord just gave him grace to move on, and he had such an attitude. And this is where I take my point. You're probably thinking, what is he talking about? Here's where I'm taking my point. The man names his son to imply that he's forgot all the toil and the mistreatment of his life. I wish today the members of Mountain View Baptist Church, and I wish today the Christians from churches all over the world, all from one state to the other, would choose to forget the mistreatment of the person that sits on the other side of the church. I wish that I could forget the mistreatment that's happened to my family in the ministry. I wish you could begin to forget the mistreatment of things that have befallen of your life. Joseph said, "Hey, it is what it is, but I'm not going to major on it. I'm not going to live on that. I'm not going to dwell on my brethren and how they treated me. I'm not going to dwell on how that old heifer Potiphar's wife tried to trap me and get me in sin. I'm just going to go on for God, and I'm just going to choose to forget." I wish we had some more Joseph that said, "Hey, everything has turned out the way I didn't want it to turn out, but I choose to forget." And I know you're thinking, "How he just named his son that." Well, why does the Bible say that? It's that for God said he had made me to forget. He chose to forget. God had helped him forget. He moved on. Said, "I'm not going to stay there, and I'm not going to dwell there, and I'm not going to major on what happened. Can we move on?" I know things happened, and I know people did wrong, and I know people, they treated the church wrong, and they treated God's people wrong, and they treated you wrong, and individuals over the course of your life have done you wrong. But Joseph, has anybody been more done wrong than Joseph? The man chose to forget and go on. My burden tonight, I'm burdened. To be honest with you, I guess I've preached here 8 or 9 times, and I've never stood in this pulpit with such a burden on my heart. Never. And the Lord's touched me. I feel like I felt God touch me in this pulpit, but I'm burdened tonight. Can we move on? Can the things that's happened to me in my life, can the things that's happened to you in your life, can we lay it aside and say, "I'm just going to choose to forget. I'm just going to choose to be like Christ, and I'm gonna turn the other cheek, and I'm going to go on." It's what Joseph did. He refused to be bitter and dwell on the bad. That's my first point of the message. Look in verse number 52. The Bible says this: "The name of the second was called Ephraim, for God hath caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction." Hey, I'd say it was affliction. I've not known affliction like Joseph's known. I've never known my brothers to hate me. I've never known my brothers in Christ to hate me. As far as I know, there's nobody in this building that hates me. Y'all may think some weird things about me and have some opinions, but that's fine. As far as I know, you don't hate me. I've never known such affliction. The Bible says in verse 52, "In the name of the second was called Ephraim, for God hath caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction." Not only did he choose to not remember, not only did he choose to not dwell on, not only did he choose to not major on the treatment, he chose not to be bitter, but then he said, "I'm not going to do anything negative. I think I'll just go be positive." He said, "I'll just go and be fruitful." That's what the Bible says the young man did. He wasn't majoring on his treatment. He said, "I'm just going to be fruitful where God's put me." Listen to me. Tonight, things may have happened unfavorably in your past. Things may happen unfavorably in the future, but we can still be fruitful in affliction. Joseph said, "I will not be unfruitful in affliction." We're talking about a man that's away from home. He's not where he was raised, not where he was intended to live. He's not there anymore. He don't have his family to share meals with on Sunday. He's literally in a separate country with separate people. The man's been in jail before. He's been delivered out of that. And he's being fruitful. Everything he touches, God blesses. Listen, God don't bless somebody with an attitude. God don't use somebody that's bitter. God doesn't dwell. And listen, I'll just say this, man, this is really where we're at. God don't really move in atmospheres where there's bitter people. He just ain't interested. Can I be honest with you? I'm going to be straight with you. If it's a famine around here spiritually and our services are dry, The Lord ain't changed. I think we might ought to check up on where we're at. Have we decided to be unfruitful? Have we decided to major on what somebody did some number of years ago? Have we decided to major on how a family member treated us, and now we're bitter and we come to church mad and there's no love in our spirit? It's possible that when God's withdrawn His presence, it's not because God's not full of mercy and He wants to dwell with us, but maybe we come to church with too much on our shoulders, too majoring on ourselves and consumed with the affairs of life and how people have treated us. And we come to church mad at one on this side of the church and not fellowshipping with one in the back because of how they do something or what they said. It's not how Joseph was. He decided to be fruitful anyway. And I don't know what time it is. I guess I should check, but I don't have my phone. Let's go to Genesis 45. That's my first 2 points. And I'll finish the message. I'll wrap it up in Genesis 45. Let's go ahead and read the text again. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood before him, and he cried, caused every man to go out from me. And they stood no man with him, while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren. Let me pause for a second and bring you along by way of summary from Genesis 41 to Genesis 45. The famine that we talked about that was impending, that God had already showed Joseph in a dream, did indeed come. Joseph had went out before the fields, and he had brought in all the supply of the corn, and he had filled up the storehouse, and he had done everything that God had showed him to do, and everything that Pharaoh said, I need you to be that man. He had done it. He had gathered it. We enter into the famine. The years of famine do indeed come, and around Genesis 41, 42, 43, all them verses, it all kind of blends together in my mind. My mind just kind of gets all scrambled together. So I may not be telling you the verses right, but I promise you between verses 41 to 45, what you see there is the famine coming and the famine starting. And what happened in those chapters, in those verses, is Jacob, which is Joseph's father, he told his brothers, he said, boys, you know, we're running out of food. We don't have any food. We're not going to make it. You know, the land is in famine. And if we don't get some corn, if we don't get some meal, if we don't get some food, boys, we're not going to make it. I need you. I've heard. It's what Jacob said to his sons. And he said, I've heard there's some food over in Egypt. And I heard there's a man there that's selling food. And they've laid up storehouse and they laid up stock. And well, I heard there's nourishment in Egypt. And I need you boys to go. I need you to get some corn. I need you to bring it home, give you some money. We're not going to make it if we don't get some corn. Long story short, y'all know the story. Jacob, Joseph's brothers, they did go indeed to Egypt. And when they come to Egypt, they found Joseph, but they did not recognize Joseph. They seen him. They seen him as the Lord over the city and the Lord over the corn and the man managing the storehouse, so to speak. And they seen him, but they did not recognize him. But Joseph recognized them. And the Bible said, it's in the text, I'm not going to go to it and read it, but it says that he recognized them and he knew them. The Bible said that he knew them. Listen, when Joseph's brothers come to him needing corn, he knew who they were. He remembered their faces. He remembered their names. But the Bible said that they did not realize it was him. So what would happen is Joseph would begin to screen them, and he told them that he had dreamed a dream, and he said, I believe you men are spies, and you've come here to Egypt to see about this corn and see about what's going on here. And he was just troubled, and you would think that he was trying to give them the cold shoulder, but I don't believe he was doing that. In my own heart of hearts, in my own mind, in my own understanding of the way I've interpreted the Word of God, is I believe that from the very moment Joseph seen his brothers, it was a reunion in his heart. He's like, there's my brothers. Listen, he wasn't bitter. He got over all that. He was been fruitful. He'd moved on. I believe he seen his brothers and he was almost joyed. And I know he troubled them. I know he kind of gave them a little bit of a cold shoulder. But I really believe in my heart that he told them to go home and he said, I'll give you some food. But he knew, he did the math. He said, I'm one of 12. And I have 11 brothers, but one's missing. And he sent them home and he basically said, you know, we'll give you some corn if you come back and prove to me that you have another brother. And do you have a father, he said in the verses in there. I believe all along Joseph was not trying to not give them any food. He was not trying to give them anything. He was not trying to withhold anything from them. I believe Joseph just wanted to check on his brother. He wanted to check on his dad. And I really think he wanted to see if his rotten brothers had had a change of heart, a change of attitude. And he knew, he's like, if they can go home and bring me, I believe it was Benjamin. Is that right, preacher? It was Benjamin, the younger brother. Yes. that can bring me my younger brother and prove to me that he's able and he's healthy and he's fine, maybe it's possible that in Joseph's flesh, he wanted to make sure that maybe dad didn't take an affinity to Benjamin and maybe his evil brothers didn't do the same thing to Benjamin that they had done to him. But overall, Joseph was not God. He could not see what was behind him. He was a man like you and I. I literally believe in my heart, and I really hope I'm not just throwing you off, but I believe Joseph, more than anything, was just trying to make sure. He was wanting to see how his brothers were. I believe he was a little bit weary to give them the corn. Maybe he was worried because of their past sins that maybe he was concerned that they would take the corn and go do as they would please with it and not take it home to dad and not take it home to the family farm. A long story short is the brothers did indeed go home. They told the dad, said, listen, we found a guy there. He sent us home with some corn. Matter of fact, he didn't even charge them for it. He sent them back with all the money they had that they come to buy the corn with. Didn't even charge them because his heart was, there was an affinity again to his brothers. And they come back to the dad and they said, dad, we bought the corn, but this gentleman over here, this lord of the city, he perceived us to be spies and he kind of dealt with us harshly. And he didn't give us a bountiful supply. He didn't even charge us. He sent us back with the same money we went there to pay with, but he gave us sackfuls of corn. And long story short, they would come a time where they consumed that resources. Joseph and his brother, or Joseph's brothers, his brethren, his dad at home, they consumed that resource. And Joseph's dad said, boys, listen, we're out of food again. We're going to have to go back to Egypt. We're going to have to talk to this guy, and we're going to have to get more of that corn. Well, the boys knew right away, the brothers knew right away, well, we're going to have a problem there, Dad, because he told us that when we came back, he's only given us corn if we brought the younger brother. Well, here's the thing, y'all, church. Remember, Joseph was favored more highly than his brethren. He was given the coat of many colors because the dad loved him. Well, y'all know the story. Joseph, something happened to him. Remember, they told dad maybe a beast had gotten him, had killed him, and they took the coat of many colors home to dad, stained with blood, and they had no Joseph. There stands Jacob, heartbroken, the loss of a son whom he loved. And the son that Joseph said, you have to bring the younger son home, was Benjamin. Well, Jacob said, no, I've already lost one son. You're not taking my other baby. Because what if mischief befails him? Peradventure, something happens to him. And then I've lost two sons in which I love. Jacob said, listen, you're not taking your younger brother. Long story short, the boys just said, Dad, listen, that guy over there in Egypt's not giving us no more corn unless we bring our younger brother. He's going to think we're a spy, and he thinks we're up to no good. We've got to go with the younger brother. And the dad says, well, why'd you even tell him you had a younger brother? And the boys told dad, he said, well, Dad, basically, it's like he already knew us. He knew we had a younger brother, and we didn't even say anything to him. I'm summarizing it, y'all, but there's so much in this text, in these verses. Long story short, and I'm tired of saying that. I'm sure y'all are tired of hearing me say that. They ultimately decide there's no other way, means of survival. We have to go back to Egypt. We have to take Benjamin, and we have to go home. We have to go to Egypt. We have to present ourselves to this man named Joseph again, this corn keeper. Can we call him the corn keeper? We're going to starve to death. We've got to go back, and we've got to do what he said we've got to do. We've got to take Benjamin with us. That brings us to chapter number 45 of Genesis. We'll read our text verses again, and we'll close the message. Then Joseph said, do not refrain himself before all them that stood by him. And he cried, cause every man to go out from me. I want to tell you this. His brothers have come back. And now for the first time in all their transactions, Joseph is revealing himself to his brethren. And it says this, then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him, and he cried. The young man, here's the young man Joseph, and he falls apart. He begins to cry. He begins to weep. And instantly, notice what your Bible says, and he wept aloud, and the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard. I love this verse. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph. Doth my father yet live? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. For the first time in all these transactions, Joseph's brothers just now realized, oh my goodness, this is our brother. We threw him in a pit and left him to die. We didn't love him. We hated him. We treated him wrong. Now this is the very man that we need to supply our need to live. They were broken in their spirit. I'm amazed by that. They didn't apologize, but they were broken in their spirit. And I preached past this, but in Genesis 42, verse number 21, when Joseph was troubling them about being spies, The Bible says they said this, and they said one to another, this is his brothers talking amongst themselves, and they said one another, we are very guilty concerning our brother. And they were talking about Joseph, but they were talking amongst themselves while Joseph was nearby. And Joseph watched this. He heard this with his ears. And it says that we saw the anguish of his soul when he besought us, and we would not hear. Therefore, his distress came upon us. And Reuben answered him, saying, I spake unto you. And this is going back. Reuben said, I tried to tell y'all not to kill him. I spake unto you, saying, do no sin against the child, and yet you would not hear. Therefore, behold, also his blood is required. They're basically saying, hey, we're under judgment. This man won't give us any meal, and it's because we're paying for our sin back years ago. It's what Joseph's brothers were saying. And the Bible said this in verse 23, and they knew not that Joseph understood them, for he spake unto them by an interpreter. They didn't know that Joseph had witnessed seeing them talk about it. They didn't know that Joseph had witnessed them referencing their past and acknowledging they did wrong. And from Genesis 41 to Genesis 45, you'll find no place where the brothers got together in the huddle and repented of their sin. You'll find no place where they admitted, hey, we killed Joseph and we shouldn't have done it. They admitted it in those verses in Genesis 42. But then you come to Genesis number 45, and there's been no time where they have come to Joseph and said, Joseph, we realize it's you and we want to apologize. We want to tell you we did wrong. There's no time where that happens. There's no scripture that verifies that. But in the Bible, in chapter number 3 of Genesis 45, it says, and Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph, doth my father yet live? And his brethren would not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. Verse number 4, and Joseph said, and I want y'all to pay attention. If you've missed this whole message, please pick it up right here. Genesis 45, verse number 4, and Joseph said unto his brethren, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near. Ain't that like Christ? Joseph's being like Christ right now. He's telling the very men that wanted to kill him to come near. They're ashamed and they're broken and they're realizing for the first time, this is the very man we just conspired to kill. We hated, we made fun of him, we sold him for our gain. And he's not shooing us away. He's saying, come near. He's being like Jesus right here. And I am Joseph, it says, and he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. Look at the verse. Now therefore be not grieved nor angry with yourselves. What? They killed him. They wanted to kill him. They hated the man. They made fun of him. And he's telling the very men that hated him, the very men that wouldn't talk peaceably to him, his brethren, his blood brothers, be not angry with yourselves that you sold me hither, for God did send me before you to preserve life. What is Joseph saying right here? Joseph said, oh, boys, don't worry about it. Yeah, what happened in the past, but it was just all God's will. It was just all God's plan. God had to have me in Egypt. God had to have somebody to fill up the storehouses. God had a plan for my life, and I never would have fulfilled that plan had y'all not did what y'all did. Listen, he's not saying, how dare y'all killed me when I was 17? How dare y'all hated me? How dare you threw me away? How dare you put me in a pit? How dare you sold me into slavery for your profitable gain? How dare you go home to dad and lie and say, oh, a beast consumed him and we've got the coat and it's covered in blood? No, none of that. He said, oh, boys, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Listen, hey, he's forgiven them. And I know what you're thinking. Well, I can't forgive somebody that's never asked for forgiveness. Listen, the brothers have never asked for forgiveness, ever. But Joseph in Genesis 42 or 43, when they talked amongst themselves and said, boys, it's our fault. We killed Joseph. We conspired to kill him. And Joseph on the other side of the hall or wherever they were, he observed it. You know what I believe he observed? He observed a change of character. He observed in their personality, in their spirit, in their language. He observed a change of course. He said, oh, them boys realize what they did is wrong now. They realize they shouldn't have done that. Joseph's not worried about an apology. He's already seen a change of heart. He's not worried about an apology. Should they have given one? Absolutely. Can I tell you this morning, tonight, this is my burden. Have things transpired in God's church that we deserve an apology for? Absolutely. Have things happened in your life with relationship from individual to individual that you deserve an apology for? Absolutely. But can I tell you this, according to the scripture, according to this picture of forgiveness, according to this picture of no bitterness, According to this picture of Joseph being a type of Christ, there was no apology, but Joseph observed a spirit and a change of character. Remember, they dealt with the fact that they were being judged for their sin, and it grieved them. Then verse number 3, it says this in Genesis 45, verse 3, for they were troubled at his presence. Now they're literally broken in their spirit, and they're in a place where, oh my goodness, could you imagine? You know what it is? You know what I see, Pastor? I see godly sorrow. I see some men that realize we've done wrong, and we've been outside of the parameter of God's will, and we've done what is not right, and it breaks their heart. I believe that's all that Joseph needed to see. I don't believe he needed it. I don't believe he needed his brothers to get down on their knees and begging for forgiveness. He had seen what he needed to see. Can I say this to you? And this is part of my message. If somebody's done you wrong, and listen, it's all the Lord. The pastor's message this morning was what it was, and my message tonight is what it is. The Lord worked all that out, and I know in my heart that I had to preach this. It's no mistake. I ask you this. If you can't relate to a time where somebody said, I'm sorry, where somebody acknowledged what they did to the church, where somebody acknowledged what they did to you personally, if somebody can't acknowledge what they've done to you directly in speaking or action, but you can look at their life and observe a change of character. If you can look at their life and observe a change of course and say, hey, I realize this individual fell off the wagon. But hey, he got back on the wagon. I realize this lady, she fell off the wagon, but she's got back on the wagon. And while she's never come to me and said, hey, I'm sorry, I know I did wrong, can we be like Joseph and just observe a change of character and say, oh, it's okay, it's okay, it's all right. That's what he's saying to his brethren, y'all. That's what he's saying without spelling it out. And then he begins to say this. Now therefore be not grieved nor angry with yourselves that you sold me hither, for God did send me here before you to preserve life. You know, it'd be good for all of us. You know, it'd be good for me. You know, it'd be good for you. You know, it'd be good for us as a church when we look at the situations that we've all lived through and say, you know what, it wasn't good. We didn't enjoy it. It was painful and it was hurtful, but God meant it for good. God brought us through the other side and we're okay. That's what Joseph's saying to his brothers. He's saying, boys, don't trouble yourself. Don't beat yourself up. God meant it for good. And then the Bible says in verse 6, for these 2 years hath famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there still shall neither be earing nor harvest. What he's saying, he said, boys, we're only 2 years into this thing. There's 5 more years coming. And listen, if by way of providence, if things that happened hadn't transpired and God didn't bring me here, I wouldn't be here to get the corn. I wouldn't have been here to gather it up. And I wouldn't be here to distribute it. That's what Joseph's saying. He's saying, oh, don't worry about it. It was just all God's plan. Listen, I can't control what happens in my life. You can't control what happens in yours. But I believe it'd do us all well. Instead of sitting around mistreating people, having a bad spirit, have an unforgiving spirit, and a spirit of bitterness, and a spirit of unfruitfulness because of circumstances and things we've lived through, I believe we all just take on the attitude of Joseph and say, hey, oh God knew what he was doing through it all. God had a plan. Yeah, it was unfavorable. We didn't enjoy it, but God's brought us to the other side, and now we're here. So let's just go on, and let's just do what God said do. And God sent me before you to preserve your posterity in the earth and to save your lives by great deliverance. Ain't that something? Ain't that something? The very men that tried to kill him, now he's saving them. I can't say it any plainer than this. There's been no man on this earth that's ever walked on this earth outside of Jesus Christ that was hated like Joseph that I find in the Bible. I'm sure there may be one. Listen, I'm a novice. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know anything. But when Jesus Christ was on Golgotha's hill, they spit on him. They whipped him with a cat of nine tails. They cursed him. They poked fun at him. Oh, if you be God, save yourself. They made fun of him. They plucked his beard. They placed the crown of thorns so deep on his head that blood ran down on his face. And in his dying breaths, before he gave up the ghost, what did he say? He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know they're killing the Son of God. They don't know that they're killing their own Savior. He said, forgive them. They don't know. What did Joseph's doing? He said, oh, boys, you didn't know. You didn't know you'd need me, but it's okay. He's saying, I forgive you. By way of his action, they've not even brought forth an attitude they've not even said, Joseph, we're sorry. But they bore an attitude and a character change, and they show the brokenness of repentance. And Joseph's saying, it's okay. It's okay. I wish we'd be like Jesus. I wish we'd be like Joseph. The very men that done us more wrong than anybody in this world,
You find Joseph being forgiving, and you found Jesus being forgiven. I do him wrong all the time. I don't like to admit this, but in the next 7 days, I'll do something stupid. I'll either talk about somebody or I'll have a bad attitude. And I'll have to say, Lord, you didn't deserve that. I'm sorry. He won't hold it over my head. Look with me now in Genesis 45, verse 15, and I promise I'm done. And he fell upon his brother. You go down through this, and just more of what we've already read is continued. Genesis 45, verse 14, and he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, and Benjamin wept on his neck. I want you to notice something. There's a young man there in Genesis 14 named Benjamin. Benjamin was the younger brother. Benjamin was at home when his other 10 brothers tried to kill him. Benjamin was at home when they threw him in the pit. Benjamin was at home when they sold him. Benjamin was at home when they took the coat of many colors covered in blood and took it home to dad and made up a lie and a story. Benjamin had no dealings with all of that that I find from Genesis 37 to Genesis 45. It's easy for Joseph to fall on Benjamin's neck. Benjamin ain't done nothing wrong. Benjamin is associated with them by relationship only. He wasn't a part of their sin. He wasn't a part of their action. But I'm glad it doesn't stop in verse number 14 where he only embraces Benjamin. Hey, we can embrace the saints of God that's never done us no wrong all day long. And we should, and I'm glad we can. But Joseph didn't just embrace Benjamin. Look what your Bible says in verse number 15. Moreover, he kissed. And we ain't talking about Benjamin. We're talking about Joseph. And it says, moreover, he kissed all his brethren and wept upon them. And after this, his brethren talked with him. Verse number 15. Moreover, he kissed all his brethren. And I hate to make it sound this way, but who do we need to kiss tonight? It's one thing to kiss Benjamin. Benjamin didn't really do Joseph no wrong. But it says he fell. Moreover, he kissed all his brethren. Reuben, all of them. Judah, every one of them. He embraced them and he kissed them. I find no better example of perfect forgiveness outside of what you find for Christ and his love for us in all the Bible than a man named Joseph. I feel like what needed to be preached has been preached. I hope I can be a Joseph. When the time comes in my life, when an individual does me wrong, I hope I can be a Joseph. Can I say this? I hope for every one of us as a church, I say this respectfully, discernibly. If it seems like somewhat of a famine in your spiritual life, if it seems like somewhat of a famine, can I just be real with you? If it seems like somewhat of a famine in our church's life right now, like, oh man, we used to have them services where the Lord would fling the doors open, he'd come in here and we'd shout for 45 minutes, preacher wouldn't get to preach. Been a while, hadn't it? Been a minute. I love the Holy Spirit and I love it when he shows up, but we'll just be honest with you, we all realize that he used to shine his face on us a little more than what he has been here lately. I'm not trying to be negative, but I wonder if maybe some of that ain't our fault. I wonder if there's not some bitterness in your heart towards somebody on the other side of the church. I wonder if there's not some indifference. And last of all, I wonder if there's not some unforgiveness somewhere. And maybe God's got us in a season of famine in our church because somebody said, well, that person did something they never apologized for. Joseph's brothers never offered him an apology. Joseph observed an attitude and a character from them that showed brokenness. And brokenness is repentance. He's seen all he needed to see. How do you measure up? How do I measure up? I'm a long way from a Joseph, and I admit that to you. This is far easier preaching than it is living. And I just ask all of you tonight, my closing statement, I take out of verse number 15. Moreover, he kissed all his brethren. Is there anybody that we need to kiss? I'm done, Pastor, you come.
Preach years ago, come on with a song. And he preached